use the principle. So what nature does is, we talked a bit, uses light to move electrons to separate charges across an interface, and then it makes fuel by using processes of chemical conversion, and it splits water. Water, of course, because that's the only chemical available in the planet that's sufficiently abundant for this process. And so we're trying to use artificial processes for this. We're using titanium dioxide. It's a semiconductor material. It's very cheap, one of the cheapest materials. You use it every day, or you're exposed to it every day. If you brushed your teeth this morning with toothpaste, that's titanium dioxide. It's the base filler for toothpaste. And you have a lot of it in you. It's white. It's the basis for white paint. So there's been a lot of analogy in solar energy conversion. If we can come up with a process that is as cheap as paint, then we're good to go. So that's what we need to do. And titanium dioxide, of course, is paint. So it's cheap as paint. So that's where we're choosing that, and we're trying to come up with chemical processes to do water oxidation and fuel formation. So that's the real key. As I mentioned, water oxidation, water splitting is really one of the hardest parts of this. And so we're trying to do that. And maybe I won't go into great detail, but we're trying to come up with artificial systems where we can make a material where we shine light on it, and we'll see bubbles of oxygen coming off on one side and transfer electrons and make bubbles of hydrogen. And our initial results, this is just now unpublished results, is just showing the electrical current that's flowing from this process. We're actually been successful by using chemicals that we've designed on using titanium dioxide. And this is electrical current that's flowing here when we shine light on it, showing a sustained electrical current is telling us that we actually are splitting water, we're actually making fuel, hydrogen in this case, with light. The current level, though, is pretty low. It's not that efficient. So we need to learn how to do it better and more efficiently. And that's basically where we are. And I just end here just to show you. Here's our solar group again. This is my own research group. About half of us work on natural photosynthesis. We try to understand how nature does it. The other half works together with these guys on this artificial solar energy conversion process. And that's something we're hopeful we can make a contribution to this. I think this is one of the, as Richard Smalley said, this is one of humanity's really grand challenges. Can we come up with a sustainable energy system for the planet, and can we power the planet with renewable energy?
Okay, question. How far away would you say we are from something viable in terms of artificial photosynthesis?
Yeah.
In those 20 years?
So we can do it right now. So we could, for example, we could take our silicon solar panels, photovoltaic panels, put them on an array, make electricity with them. We have water electrolysis methods. There's a company out in Wallingford called Proton Energy. They make the world's most efficient water electrolyzers, and I don't know if anyone here knows about Proton Energy. They were actually just in the news about a week ago because they just signed a contract with Toyota. If you read the business section of the New Haven Register, they signed a contract with Toyota. Toyota is going to provide 10 hydrogen-powered cars, and Proton Energy is going to make hydrogen by water electrolysis, and they're going to use sunlight to do it. Now, this is not something we're going to see stations all over the place because it's going to be very expensive to run these cars, but it's really a demonstration that you can do it. So to answer your question, we can already do it. It's just that it's not anywhere close to cost competitive with fossil fuels right now. So going forward, we either have to dramatically improve the efficiency and lower the cost of these artificial systems so that they become cost competitive with fossil fuels, or I think more likely in the near future, we're going to have to make the cost of fossil fuels really pay what their impact is, the fact of all the environmental and global consequences. We're going to have to make them more expensive by carbon taxes or cap and trade or something. And that's a political issue, but I think that's really what we have to do. And on our research side, what we're hoping to do is to take this system that Proton Energy is putting in place with filler panels and water electrolyzers, which work but are really expensive and not very efficient, and turn them into something that is relatively inexpensive and reasonably efficient so that they can really have the possibility of being economical. And right now, it's just a demonstration project.
Any more questions for Gary?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is a question. I just wanted to say
Well, thank you very much. As all of you can see, this is something I'm passionate about. and you know, all of these guys are passionate about it too. And so hopefully we'll make a difference.
No.
Yeah, Spain is one of the real leaders for renewables. Unfortunately, the Spanish economy is just tanked, and so the government support for this is not continuing. But they've developed a number of different methods for solar energy conversion. They have these heat engines that will convert sunlight into electricity that they're running. They're so-called Stirling engines, and they've got a whole bank of those in Spain. They've got all kinds of solar energy projects, and yeah, you're right. These are heat engines. Basically, they have a dish that will collect sunlight, focus it onto an engine, and that engine cranks around with just heat and turns it into electricity. And that we have actually in chemistry, we use a demonstration. We have a little Stirling engine that's made out of glass, and we can see, you know, the heat, you know, how it makes it work to illustrate the point. But they actually out in the field, they're making electricity and just using the power of sunlight. Now, that's subsidized significantly by the government. They're not really economical just on their own right now. Right now, you know, the question came, I can't remember who asked it, about wind energy. Wind systems are cost competitive right now in certain environments. I think the Phoenix wind turbine is probably not a good example of that, because we're not in an environment here where wind energy really is all that great. You know, it's not like we don't have a lot of wind capacity here. And, you know, I showed you this picture of the planet with, you know, color coded for solar capacity. There's a similar one, you can find it on the web, for wind capacity. And the northeast, yeah, we're way down. We're not a good place. So it doesn't really make a lot of economic sense to put windmills here. I mean, except, you know, politically it's good, and it does generate some electricity. But if you want to really make a significant amount of electricity with wind energy, you'd like to go someplace where the wind is, you know, sustained wind is on average, you know, 20 miles an hour. You know, North Dakota, every day the sustained wind is 20 miles an hour. Of course, in wintertime, it's biting cold too, with the wind blowing like that. But it's great for wind energy, and there's a lot of other places. Maybe some of you have been to Palm Springs in California, and you go through the pass, and you see all these windmills there, because that pass has got a lot of wind going through all the time, and they've made use of it there, and so there is a lot of capacity for wind. It's just that, in contrast to you know, some of these other systems that aren't really economical, wind can be economical right now, and I think we're seeing a huge growth of that, and especially in the Midwest. My brother works for a power contracting company, and he's big on wind energy, and he lives in Minnesota. So it really is you know, growing. Yeah.
I'm curious as to your professional opinion about some of the different geoengineering approaches.
Geothermal is another. I didn't talk at all about it, but you drill down anywhere in the ground and it gets hot, and you can extract that heat to make electricity. The problem with geothermal is that rocks don't conduct heat very, very well. So if you drill down into rocks somewhere, you know, you find heat, and you extract it out, in a few years, it's not hot anymore. The heat has to transmit through the rocks to keep it hot. And that rate of transmission of heat through rocks isn't very fast. So those wells go cold, and then you gotta drill another well. And then you gotta drill another. So it's not economical, because the cost to drill a well is too expensive, and if it runs out in a couple of years, it doesn't pay. The only places where geothermal really is cost effective is when you've got thermal processes, the conduction, you know, it's got a bed of lava where you make it. So you've got this place called, the geysers, I think, out in California. Is that the name of it? There's a geothermal power plant in California that's been in operation for more than a decade. It sits on top of a bed of magma,
And it's economical. You know, but there's relatively few places around the planet where that really works. You know, Iceland is a good example where it works. And Iceland.
Proposal some years ago exported to New England.
Right. Yeah.
It died.
Yeah. Well, Iceland's a long way from us too. And if you're going to make electricity in Iceland, you're certainly not going to send it over here because that's not going to work. But geothermal has a significant capacity, but it's a little bit misleading because you think, well, you know, there's heat everywhere. But it's really not economical, except in a very few locations around the world where you have the capacity for continued use of the thermal energy.
What about on a small scale, like just a house versus big production?
Yeah, so if you're not going to tap into it that much, I think it's great. And you may be referring to, there are processes now where for systems that you can put in to basically heat and cool or maintain temperature by having these networks of pipes in the ground outside your house. You know, so in the summertime, you pump the air through your house through them, and it cools it. In the wintertime, it warms because the ground stays pretty constant temperature around 40 or 50 degrees, probably around 50 degrees all year. And that really works, provided your house doesn't put too much of a demand on the capacity for heating and cooling in the ground. You know, if everybody starts doing this and everybody's, you know, using it at a high rate, then it's gonna become less sustainable. But right now, I think, and maybe if you have a big enough yard, you know, so that you're the only one that taps into it and it's not that big of a drain, you know, then it really works.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, thanks very much. Yeah, I think you help.
If you heard Dr. Pachauri's talk, he's the director of the O'Connor Energy Institute. I have the honor of being the deputy director. What that means is that he's the director, but he's never around. So I'm the one that actually does it.